The Angry Chicken is a production of Amove TV. Bookmark amove.tv for more gaming and esports shows. The Angry Chicken is directly supported by listeners like you via patreon.com/TAC. And if you would like to see a live recording of The Angry Chicken, come on out to CreateCon in Orlando this July. Tickets and info over at createconvention.net.
Podcast about Hearthstone, Heroes of Warcraft. This is the Angry Chicken.
Greetings and welcome back, everyone. This is the Angry Chicken. I'm Garrett Weinzerl. He's Willie Dills Gregory, and she is Jocelyn Moffat. How are you doing today, guys?
I'm good. I'm a little burned. went zip lining over the weekend. Had a family in town. Big 4th of July. Did adult slip and slide.
Looking so American, it hurts. Like, you look to
really
me.
Does it really hurt or does it feel good? Which one is
you
it?
You look
here,
to
really?
Me like you are waiting in the longest line at Disney World.
It was worse this weekend. I had American short, swim trunks, American short. Yeah, American short.
Yeah, you
tank
say
top
worse, but I don't think that's actually worse.
The one thing I can't find is, yeah, exactly. It's just better. The one thing I can't find is I had like American glasses, American flag, like the cop glasses, you know, aviators. Yeah, and I couldn't find those. I was so sad. It was the worst part of my weekend.
Oh, that's
so not being able to find those.
That's so unfortunate. I'm jealous, actually, sir. I went looking for an American flag pair of board shorts and could not find them anywhere. Of course, Walmart.
Yeah,
you know what?
The stores you were going to were too high end, Garrett.
There you go. That's what I get. That's what
bring
I get.
It down.
That's what I get for shopping at Target.
Yeah.
It's really unfortunate, but nonetheless, I'm happy to hear. So, did everyone have a good? What do you call it in Canada? Is it just Canada Day?
Yes.
It is literally just Canada Day. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, wait, you guys celebrated on the same day?
No, on the 1st. So this weekend it was like, yeah, it was really cool because like Canada Day bookended the weekend with Independence Day. So it was one big long weekend of fun.
Yeah, exactly.
So wait, so is Canada Day celebrating your independence from France? Okay. All right.
Because we technically,
Britain, sure, yeah,
yeah we just yeah. didn't, we just didn't fight for it. We just asked nicely and Britain was like, okay.
Oh, it works that way?
The all most, man. Canadian way.
We still technically have the figurehead of the Queen, but we have our own government constitution, all the rest of it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like Australia, but your accents aren't as cool.
Yeah. Hey. Whoa. That's shot true. Australian accents are really sweet. And I don't think I have an accent, so I can't really argue with that.
You don't. There's only a couple things you say where it comes out, where your Canadian-ness shows.
Yeah. Mostly sorry and about.
Mm-hmm. Pretty much. Yeah, the standard ones.
Yeah. It's kind of like
when normally.
I want to send a message out to all of my 30-plus-year-old guys out there. Don't adult slip and slide. This is a PSA. This is a warning. When you're in your 20s, oh, it's fun. Slipping and sliding around is great times. Once you cross a certain threshold, your body is just, it's too heavy for the inertia is just, it's not the ratio it once was. And basically, I got punched in the stomach by the ground. And then I
thought you were going to say, like, by your own fist or something.
No.
And to pretend like it was all fine and get up because there's little children around. But I wanted to just go into a corner and cry, really. But I toughed it out. I even went 3 or 4 more times because the kids thought it was hilarious. But, man. And then the zip lining, too. I was, like, still sore from that. And there's actually, I thought it was like, oh, I just sit in this thing, but you have to grab the thing at the end or else you'll like bounce back and then they got to go out and get you. So there's like a whole, you know, there was more athleticism involved than I expected, but it was really fun.
So what you're saying is that will teach you to stop playing Hearthstone on your tablet at a social gathering.
I should have just been doing that.
Gotcha.
What I should have been doing.
Wonderful. Your mistake was doing stuff.
I need to just whip my ass back into shape is what I probably need.
Well, it sounds like if you just keep doing slip and slide, eventually you'll get back into shape.
Exactly. Yeah.
Or get a concussion. I'm not sure. Whichever comes first.
I'm going to go on a strict slip and sliding regimen here.
Yeah.
Who needs a CrossFit? It's all about slip and slide.
Well, guys, before we get into the meat of talking about Hearthstone and Jazz, I do want to remind our listeners out there that CreateCon is coming up at a rapid pace, a pace so rapid it may be instilling anxiety in me. It's Saturday, July 30th, so it is this month. So, Jocelyn, you're going to be flying in from Canada. Mm-hmm. Dills, you're going to be flying in from Texas. And we're going to be doing a live Angry Chicken in downtown Orlando at the venue that we're having this at. So, folks,
3 weeks. I'm flying in 3 weeks.
3 weeks.
Not to stress you out even
more,
Garrett.
No, not at all.
Yeah, three
not
more
all.
Weeks.
And I'm going away for a week in the middle of this, too. So that'll be fun. It's coming up. If there's still tickets available over at createconvention.net, or you can look up CreateCon right there on Eventbrite. That's where we're selling tickets. So you should go check that out. But if you are already coming, or even if you're not, actually, you should know that we have some new T-shirt designs up for CreateCon. It's actually over on the Tadpole Big Cartel store, which you can find at tadpole.bigcartel.com. And if you want to type in /category/CreateCon, you'll actually see the shirts that I'm talking about. And if you use the code CREATE, you will get free shipping to the con floor. So you can just pick it up at the con, you know, no shipping paid. It'll be there for you. You're guaranteed to get the shirt you want, the size you want. You don't have to worry about any of that jazz. So go check it out. We have a new Angry Chicken shirt. There's a Let's Talk About Star Wars shirt, and there's an Into the Nexus shirt, because those are all live shows happening at CreateCon. So go check these out. Jocelyn and Dills, you're getting one for free, so don't worry about
what?
It.
What?
But I'm excited,
can
guys.
Can I get the Into the Nexus one?
Not for free. No. But yeah, so I'm excited, guys. It's right around the corner. I can't wait to finally. It's been a while since we've had a chance to do a live Angry Chicken in the same room together, so this is going to be a good time.
Oh yeah.
And I hear tell that it sounds like, and this is me pulling a sideways Johnson, I guess. But we're probably going to have an after party just at the venue. So we'll probably break, go to dinner, come back, and just continue partying. So we'll just turn into a big fireside. We'll start playing Hearthstone. We're going to hook up consoles on TVs. And this is all dependent on whether or not we can get a bartender or two in there. But it's looking like we can. So that's also very cool. So
that sounds awesome.
BYOB. BYO bartender.
I have no comment on that. I have no comment on that. No comment on that at all. Yeah. But
you have tack flasks, and I feel like they need to get some.
That's true. They need some use. Yeah, it's been a while since I busted mine out. Yeah.
I love mine. It is awesome. So, anyways, createconvention.net for more info on that if you want to come. Looking forward to seeing many of you guys there. But with that out of the way, let's talk some Hearthstone news.
Good news, everyone!
Guys, it's a new month, it's a new season, and we need to start getting ready to earn our half-hill card back. Oh, wait. We're not getting a half-hill card back this month. Apparently, we're getting a Tiny Fin card back, which I'm not complaining, because it looks awesome. It's sandy beaches, man. It's little, you know...
Fish bones.
Fish bones. I love fish bones. Who doesn't love fish bones? I know my cat does, but... Yeah, so it was originally announced that Half-Hill was supposed to be the card back for this month, and now it's Tiny Fin. And when asked about where the Half-Hill card was, the official Hearthstone Twitter replied, "What is this card back? None of your business."
So, I have a question.
Yep.
Did Hearthstone actually officially announce the Half-Hill card back, or was that just data mined from the patch? Because I think it was just data mined.
Most of the time, this stuff is just data mined. Yeah, I don't think they ever really announce this stuff until we know, like, the next season, until the next season's coming.
Mm-hmm. But the data mine did actually, like, it. I saw the image and it said, you know, reward for July 2016. So I'm wondering if, are we going to get different card backs, like one for wild and one for standard?
Man, that would be a lot of work for the design team. I know,
but that's, like, the only thing I can think of why.
If they did...
Two July card backs.
There could be some incentive to do something like that, but just I would think the best way to go about it, if you're the Hearthstone team, is to do something like a different version of the same card back.
Yeah.
That expresses that you got it in wild, right? So just throw a couple of, like, maybe like the border is slightly different rather than the standard kind of border they've been doing, which is like the wooden border. They make it more vines and stuff. Some leaves and whatnot thrown in there. But, you know, like, some people don't want to be forced to get to rank 20 on Wild, and, you know, they just like, I just play Standard. Now I have to get to rank 20 in Wild and Standard. That might be a little bit, but I don't know. It's fine for me. I end up in, like, I think I ended up rank 10 in Wild, just kind of through wanting to play a fun, different deck, and that's, like, a great place for it now.
And I haven't touched Wild at all since Wild was released.
Really? Like, not at all?
Not at all.
I found that later in the season, when everyone, because around, you know, I was ranked 4 on, like, the 28th or whatever, right? And I was like, I'm not going to get to Legend. I want to play a fun deck. Oh, God, everyone's tryharding, like, the most they ever will at rank 4, right, at that very end of the month. So I just thought, well, okay, let's go do something fun, and Wild was, like, the perfect answer for that. Because I could go play Reno Shaman or something like that, you know, something just totally weird and that no one's doing. And I was at rank 18, so I could just totally go in there and play. I've been playing a lot of Wild Milkshake, so.
Yeah.
It's fantastic for that, because once you've ranked up to whatever you're going to get to, you're super low on the other side.
So are you guys buying into any of the crazy, you know, tinfoil hat, half-hill truther theories out there that this has something to do with half-hill somehow involved in the next adventure or something, and that's why it's been delayed?
That was going to be my that was going to be my next point, is maybe it has to do with the adventure.
Yeah, because you guys are absolutely right. It was not officially announced by Blizzard in any regard, but this stuff has been data mined time and time again, and it's always correct. When it's placed with a certain month, because there's a month, you know, attached to the card back in the data mined information, and it's always been correct in the past. So, I mean, for me, I'm like, this could really be anything. It could be like they had a hiccup with the animation, and they're like, it's just a card back. Push it. We'll fix it later.
Is Half Hill, is that where your garden was?
Yes.
Yeah,
in Pandaria. That's where your farm was, sir.
Please don't give us a gardening adventure.
That was your farm, sir.
But it would be wild.
People really loved the gardening. I never liked the gardening.
No.
I immediately was like, really? This is...
Everyone in Half Hill hates me because I never did, like, any of that stuff. I never got my friendships or anything else. Like,
yeah. Like, yeah, make a bunch of friends and do all this. Like, oh, God. No, I don't want to do it.
I kind of dug it, honestly.
Like the first version of Garrisons, and, you know...
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's, you know, I honestly, now given that versus Garrisons, I almost would rather go back to that, because it's like, well, it's just one little thing I get to go do, and it's not completely taking up my entire experience of the game. But
plus, if one guy in your raid team really did it, then you are all fine, because then you could all have...
Like, he's got all the carrots I'll ever need.
Yeah, he's got all the feasts and everything, we're fine, no one else has to do it.
Yeah, exactly. I just did it to make gold, but... But what do you guys think? Do you think there's a chance that the next expansion is Pandaria themed in some way, shape, or form? I mean, we've gotten other Pandaria card backs that didn't lead into Pandaria content in Hearthstone before. So again, I feel like this is overreaching a bit, but I could see that. I mean, why the heck not?
I think the only reason that like people are thinking it has to do with the adventure is because of the timing of it. Like, we know that because of the release schedule that Blizzard actually gave us, we're supposed to get an adventure sometime in the next like 6 to 8 weeks. So, and I think it's going to be much, much shorter than that. I think we're still looking at an end of July type of a thing. So, I mean, that's the only reason that people think that maybe there's Pandaria involved in this adventure. I don't think it's too much of a leap because, I mean, just timing. It'd be cool. I didn't mind Panda stuff in WoW. I don't know.
There's a very cool aesthetic.
I didn't mind it either. As much crap as it got.
There's a very cool, very unique aesthetic to Pandaria, I think, in terms just of art and design. And I would be totally down to see a large card expansion in Hearthstone kind of revolve around that. Just don't go overboard on Klaxi. I don't like them as much as everything else in Pandaria.
If they do an adventure, I doubt they would be a huge part of it. You'd probably see a couple of them as cards, but...
Yeah, I mean, we just got a Klaxi Rogue Legendary in the most recent damn set of cards, so who knows?
I could go super tinfoil hat and go, maybe this is where they bring in the Shah that was missing from Old Gods.
Ooh!
Woohoo!
Ooh, although we've kind of already heard that there's not really going to be any other things that tech, like, specifically synergize with the Old Gods, so it'd be kind of an afterthought.
Yeah. I would guess if there's Shah, they would do some sort of, like, there's 7 Shah, and then they're not tied to the Old Gods at all, but their Shaw, and so they might actually end up being good with Yashiraj because they're probably also pretty powerful cards. So just like by default, they end up being good with Yashiraj, which would then make a little sense. But not like specific, yeah, not like this is supposed to go in a Yashiraj deck. Like,
yeah.
That is.
I think that could be cool if that was the adventure and then you ended up with the seven Shaw and all that kind of stuff. I see it. Totally. The one thing that I think we early on we thought, because Nax was the first one, we thought, oh, they're going to totally do this in chronological order, aren't they? And now we realize not really.
Nah. I have a feeling it when something strikes them as fun and then they start running around or running away with card ideas and it kind of clicks, you're like, cool, this is what we're going with.
Yeah,
I just really hope that if they go Panda Adventure, they don't go like Lili and Chen's Adventures Through Pandaria, because then I might just not even buy it.
Oh, come on. What's wrong with Lili, man?
Like, no, she's... I can't. No more Lili. I can't do it.
No, Lili would be great.
Chen, him doing all the like lore, if you go to that one little spot by the throne of Four Winds or whatever it is, and then you like watch all the lore things and then like all the characters come out and do it. That was awesome. I enjoyed that quite a bit.
Also,
That was Lore Walker Cho.
Thank you.
Yeah. That wasn't Chen. No, Chen.
Are you talking about just that one area? Oh, that is Half Hill, right? Yeah. There's no way they do that.
The Valley of the Four Winds.
That was a tiny quest line.
Yeah. I'm down with Chen. Lili would be great, man. They put Lili card in the game, and it's the first thing that involves like a key click. It's like hit Q, and it just auto heals the lowest health minion. Oh wait, that's Heroes. Okay.
If you draw Lili, it just auto plays it for you. You don't have to do anything.
You don't have to do anything. It does the thing you need it to do the most right now. Cool. Go.
I would guess though, if we are getting some sort of Pandaria adventure, Lili will be at least a card, if not a character in the adventure.
Oh yeah.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure. Yeah. And I'd be down with Chen. Chen should come with his own versions of poisons, which are just brews, different types of brews that do different things. Little one mana spells.
Cool. That's not bad. Yeah.
I love cards that make little one mana spells, so I'm always on the lookout for some new way to make them. And brews on Chen sounds like a cool idea.
Yeah, that sounds really cool.
But anyway, so that's what's going on with the Half Hill card back, if you're curious. So get out there, strap on your tinfoil hat, and come up with some crazy theories, everybody. We got some chattage from Ben Brode via Twitter and other places this week. He was asked if the team had considered adding more cards to the base set, either now or in the future. He said yes, but not sure it's worth it. He said it's dangerous to put too many good cards in the non-rotating sets because things can feel, quote, samey.
Yep.
Which made me so happy.
I love that word. More of that word, please.
It's also incredibly true. Every time somebody likes a card, they bring this up. Like, I really like this card. It should be in the base set. It's like, okay, you like that card. That's cool.
Yeah.
But the fact is like, if you're going to have this base set, period, I kind of think is a little dangerous because things can feel samey, right? Like, Freeze Mage may never go away because of these cards existing in the base set, right? That's not necessarily a problem, but... as long as like those archetypes have some sort of ebb and flow to them where they're more powerful when certain sets come out and things are less powerful after losing a couple cards like Mad Scientist, then it's totally fine. But yeah, you continue to add things. Because I remember somebody said something, the Echo of Medivh card, right? That it was like, this is such a cool card. Don't you think we should find a way to make this exist always? And it's like, well, yeah, but it does exist always. You just play wild. Aha, fixed. So I think a lot of people need to start recognizing wild as a legitimate format, and then maybe some of this kind of sentiment goes away, which maybe means we just need more wild tournaments and things going on in competitive wild scenes, which, you know, will happen. I still hold firm to that belief, but
yeah, I think the only problem with competitive wild right now is just that there is no kind of end game for competitive wild. Like competitive standard, you have BlizzCon is your end game with a huge prize pool, and you just don't have that on the wild side. Even if they ended up organizing tournaments, like there's just no end game. So until
there's no beginning game.
There's no game.
Yeah, right now.
Yeah. So I think until there is some sort of like continual competitive something, then I don't think that there's going to be. Yeah,
it's true. But I do believe like, once the next season starts, then I think we'll start to see some more interest in it. Just because similar, and it'll be a small.
Oh, you mean like 2017?
Yeah, like right
oh, the
now
next
it's just
year of Hearthstone?
It's a little too close to what we just got sick of and done with and moved on to the standard. So that's the real problem there. It's just that we're too close to Secret Paladin still being annoying, right? We're still too close to Pilot Shredder being just dumb, and we just don't want to go back there yet.
Right.
I've been having a great time in there with just weird Reno decks.
Yeah. It just needs to get more wild, for lack of a better word.
And
the more cards that come out, the more that is going to happen. You're absolutely right, Dills.
Yeah. So, but the fact is, like, this is why we get this sentiment right now, is people miss one card, right? That card, oh God, I missed that card. I want that card to still be a part of this set. I want to play Standard, but I want to play Standard with this specific card that I used to really enjoy.
You know, and
they don't want to bring back Sludge Belcher. They want to bring back whatever fun card they use. They want to bring back Light Bomb because Priest isn't good. Duh, because Light Bomb's gone.
Yeah, and that's totally fine. That is a perfectly okay sentiment to have because you know what? I'm there too. I miss Shielded Minibot and Muster for Battle like nobody's freaking business. But I'm also glad that things are different. Yes, Paladin is not that great right now, but it'll have its time again. Its time will come. Mm-hmm.
Well, we just had a question last week about just rotating classes like top to bottom of what's best and what isn't, and it'll all come around again.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Although Priest still needs to come around for the first time, really, which is unfortunate.
Yeah, they've made it into the mid-tier, but they've never...
They had Undertaker Priest for that little moment.
They've never been, you know, king of the castle, sadly. So, Anduin, I believe in you. One day you will be called up, sir. You will be called up by Team 5. But
although I think C'Thun Priest is a little bit more powerful than people are giving it credit for, because if you build it in a really anti-aggro way, it's already good against mid-range decks just because it has a really good finisher and its mid-range minions are pretty strong. You just need to be able to last against some of the aggro stuff early on, but once you do, you heal for 10. And then you play C'Thun, you do all this stuff. So I think it's actually pretty good.
I really like
it. No one's really teching it and figuring it out right now because it's not top tier. So no one's like, there's no pros really like working on it. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. I
get on it, pros.
Really enjoy that deck archetype.
Priest being bad is totally your fault.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Yeah. People that are better than me.
A lot, and that's it.
Yeah. Geez, people are better than me. Don't you realize you have a job to do? Come on. No, it's one of my...
But, you know, like, we've seen 7 different versions of mid-range Shaman at this point, right? Because all these pros are trying to figure out the very best version of it to take to tournaments. If Priest was in that category, we would be seeing 7 different versions of C'Thun Priest or whatever. Things have, like, changed little bits over time, but they're really changing the most with the decks that we know are pretty strong.
And speaking of things, maybe possibly, who knows, read into this too much, get your tinfoil hat back out, possibly changing. When asked if they were happy about the current ladder system, Ben Brode said that, "I think there is room for improvement. We've been discussing it recently."
I'm so happy about this comment. I can't even express how happy I am about this comment.
I knew that they were discussing it because when I did that Legend video, Ixar hit me up and said that he really appreciated the comments in it and they enjoyed the feedback and it's been something they've been talking about. So I was like, oh, okay, cool. Because I, you know, didn't know that. And that was, you know, a few months ago now. Mm-hmm. So I know they've been thinking about it. They've heard our stuff that we've said about it. I know, you know, we've had some private conversations with some people from Blizzard about stuff in the past.
It's happened multiple times where we've had a chance to talk with the devs in a one-on-one environment and they seem very interested because it always turns into this. Well, what do you think is wrong? How would you fix it? Tell me.
Exactly.
I want feedback.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The tricky thing with any ladder system is you do want it to be hard to get to the top, right? Because that's it's important that the people at the top are representative of the best players, right? That's very important. But I guess the real question is with a game like Hearthstone, like, how much do you, like, my quibble with it, my problem has always been, you essentially have 2 ranks, not 26 ranks. You have Legend and not Legend. And that to me is just, it's just like, that's not fun for everyone who's not Legend when there's this other thing. And that, like, I want people to be proud that they got to 15. And we get these, you know, emails all the time from people basically crapping on themselves because the highest I've ever been is 15. It's like, dude, that needs to be shown to be better than what you think it is, because it is actually better. Like when you hover over that little rank and you see that you're top 20% or whatever, that it needs to feel like you're top 20%, but it feels like you're bottom of the barrel to all those players. That I think is a big problem.
Yeah, I mean, let's bring in the other pool of games, because this discussion is happening a lot right now in Heroes and Overwatch
as
well.
Games, by the way.
Yeah. All Blizzard games that have a competitive ladder in this way. Diablo's different, has a leaderboard, it's a completely different game. But Overwatch just added its competitive mode, which has a what I think is a rather absurd competitive system where you go from 1 to 100 and every possible integer in between.
It's pretty lame.
Which I think is extremely strange. And then Heroes just moved away from a similar system.
Was reversed and 1
yes,
through 50.
Yes, and 50 through 1, which, reverse. So almost closer to Hearthstone, and that you start at a high number and you work your way to a low number and eventually get the legend. So it's strange. And so Heroes now has adopted something more similar to StarCraft and what Hearthstone actually had during the beta when it first came online. We had Bronze up through Diamond. Or was Master in there?
No, actually, Grandmaster was the highest one.
Was Grandmaster in there, or was it just Master?
It was Grandmaster. You had Master, then Grandmaster. Because I remember when I got to Grand, there was Grandmaster 3 stars. And people would make posts on Reddit, I'm a Grandmaster 3 stars player. But at the time, you never lost any ranks at all. So it literally was just everybody who played long enough.
Yeah, because I got
all
there.
Ended up at Grandmaster.
I couldn't remember what the top was. I just know I got there. And I was just like, this seems easy because I know I'm not that good.
Everybody got there. It just was a matter of how fast.
I didn't get
you
there.
You just didn't play enough. That's all.
It was literally hours put in, like more so than ever before. But that's like, I don't necessarily think that's wrong. It's just that version was wrong. But because I always come back to Bronze through Grandmaster. I like that because in the world of Hearthstone, you have 25 through 1, and then you have Legend. And you're talking about this 15 gap, and 15 actually seems to be a point where a good majority of players reach, where the game itself at the end of the season is like you ranked in, top 25% or whatever it is, where you should feel good about it, but it doesn't. And I think it's just because there's 15 more ranks, and then there's Legend after that. Mm-hmm. And there's something about, I think, just having Bronze, Silver, Gold, Platinum, Diamond, Master, Grandmaster, that, yes, there's way less diamonds, but for the sake of argument, say this because I don't have the stats to go off of. I can't see their internal stats, but I would assume, let's say that the amount of players in Hearthstone that range between 15 and 1 is akin to the amount of players that range between Diamond and Platinum in Heroes.
Mm-hmm.
That to me makes more sense to me, and I like that better. And it also gives us as a community something that we can tie our boat to, and we can use as this common talking point. In the community, it's like, well, what level are you? Well, I'm Diamond. Oh, cool, I'm Diamond too. We're Diamond buddies, or whatever it is.
Yeah. Also, I think that there's a weird disconnect between, like, some people where Legend matters a lot, right? And then some people where it just all that matters to them is top 100 now, right? Legend is like just doesn't matter at all to them anymore. Now it's just top 100. So you've got like all these different weird pools of people where different things matter, and there's not really any feeling of coherence amongst the entire player base. It's like I would like it if I actually think what Heroes is doing is actually pretty good, outside of the fact that Heroes the game isn't really lend itself to this working out so well without some tweaks. But Grandmaster is the top 500 players, period, right?
Yeah.
And then so you got Master, so you could just kind of take away Legend, because most people who are caring about the top Legend, like Master is that. And then there's those people who are trying to get BlizzCon points, right? And those are the only ones who we really need to concern ourselves with as Legend players or whatever.
It would be great. I mean, heck, you can have Legend or Grand Legend or whatever stupid name you want to come up with it. I mean, but it would be cool if there was something like that in Hearthstone, a top one, like a best of the best top 100 that is its own league that you can fall back out of because it has HCT points attached to it.
Yeah, and you need like a visualization of how many games I need to get there. What kind of, what do I need to do to get into that league? How close am I to falling out? What do I need to keep playing? I think that's another thing, too, that when I talk to, because really the ladder system is, it's going to be hard to make it good for everybody. I mean, I think actually impossible to be good for everybody. But we should try to make it as good as it can be for people of all levels if we're really going for the ultimate goal. So those players who are going for HCT points, because that matters a lot to them, there's a lot of money on the line, their complaints are things like, I don't know how close I am to the next guy. So I don't know if I should be queuing. And all of a sudden, there's this weird gap at the end of the season, the last 5 hours, the last 1 hour, where everything matters a lot. People do weird things like rope every turn because they're trying to make the game go as slow as possible because they're losing. So they hope that the game doesn't end up counting and things like that. And all of that is negative in the grand scheme of things. And then you've got players where this doesn't matter at all. They just need to feel better about rank 15. So it's like, how do you really tie all that together? I don't know.
Well, I think it has a lot to do with like we're talking about this kind of rank 15 milestone. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, if you want to look at rank 15, even as like, I'm going to go back to like my StarCraft experience. When I finally got into silver in StarCraft, I was on the top of the freaking world because like I'd been a bronze player for so, so long. I'm not very good at the game, but I worked and then I, you know, ended up in silver and I felt great about that. And I feel like if you work to get to 15, there's still, you know, you're still in the bottom of the ranks because there's 10 ranks below you and 15 ranks above you plus legend on top of that. So you don't feel like you've even gotten halfway up the ladder. And it just doesn't feel like that rewarding. And I think a lot of that too, like I think a lot of the ladder issues in general are really tied into the fact that we don't really have an MMR. Like there is no rating of your skill, which has always been my problem with it, especially very early on in the season, because you get people who are legend players at rank 16. And if you're actually a rank 10 player, you're just like, well, why should I even queue in right now? Because I'm queuing into people who have a skill level very, very, very above mine. So
I think the MMR doesn't matter until you're actually legend. Like outside of that, it's just queuing you with players close to your rank. Yeah.
Right. Well, exactly. Yeah. Your rank is your MMR, which I think is a really, really big problem and makes the ladder not very fun and not very rewarding for the kind of the really important parts of the month, right at the beginning and right at the end. So I don't know. I think that having some sort of a system with groupings and actual MMRs might be better than stars and ranks.
Well, like a soft MMR reset at the end of each season where then players have to kind of, you know, players who are worse get a little, like we squish a little and then we let them spread out again, but not squish. Because right now, you're right, it squishes legend all the way down.
Yeah.
Because like at legend, you drop down to, I think, rank 16.
Yeah.
You know, the season I was legend, the very beginning of the next season, I was ranked 16.
Yeah, and whereas so like I
if I take 3 days off, all of a sudden I'm playing the people who are, you were like, 10 or 12 or whatever, right? They're in the same thing as the guy who was legend last season. And that
That feels bad for the person who
that's a big...
consistently gets to between 5 and 10 because then I get dropped down to 17 or 18 depending on where exactly I shake out. So I'm within one rank of legend players and it's just like, okay.
We shouldn't incentivize not playing. I think is a very big point of
which
what
is how
said.
I feel. Yeah. I feel like I shouldn't even bother.
Incentivized to sit and wait. For all of those good players to kind of work their way out.
There's so many, there's a lot of facets, a lot of, once you crack open the discussion, as everyone can see, we literally are talking about two sentences. I think there is room for improvement. We've been discussing it recently. Once you crack that open, there's such a network of rabbit holes to go through. It looks more like an anthill if you were to get a cross section of it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And there's so much to discuss and like, I'm not even sure where, because then you, like, you talk about the soft MMR reset, Dills. Like, yes, there should be something. Do we include placement matches now? Because we're seeing that in things like Overwatch and Heroes. Should we have placement matches in Hearthstone? And there's, I don't know, there's a lot to wrap your head around. And so for me at the moment, I've just, my brain at least, where I've been focusing is just, what rank system we would like? What is our carrot? What is our stick? What are they showing us that's going to make us find the fun in what is really a grind, and honestly, whether at the end of the day is placebo, because if we had an MMR, like a proper MMR system, and again, this starts to tilt in the Heroes discussion a little bit, but one of the things some players have been asking for in Heroes is just show us our MMR, just show us the number. And while I understand that, I also understand the push away from that, because that you start getting that discussion of the science of fun, and it's like if we're just looking at like a four-digit number, it's not very gamified. I'm not incentivized to work on that, to move in. We've even heard from the Heroes developers that your actual MMR does not change that much over the course of a season. So I like I said, I don't know what the answer is, but for me, I think like the Bronze through Grandmaster system or something more akin to that, where it's a larger grouping, and you can have subsections between it, like we have in Heroes with, you know, gold 5-1, platinum 5-1, etc. But something like that, where you at least have some type of umbrella grouping a much larger group section of players together, to me makes more sense. And like you said, Jocelyn, there's something about it. There's something that when in StarCraft, there was something now in Heroes about moving from silver to gold, from bronze to silver, from gold to platinum, that just feels like a bigger moment. Even if you were to peel that layer back and see that your MMR number has changed maybe 20 digits, it makes you want to play. It makes you feel rewarded. And that's my anecdotal ramble.
No, I agree. I think there's definitely some sort of system out there where, rather than it being about the amount of games you play, because, you know, that's the thing we hear about all the time, it really is just about separating players based on how much they actually win and lose. Not depending on, okay, I played 300 games, I got to Legend. What was your win percentage? 55%. It's like, all right, well, I played 90 games and I won 75%. Does that mean that I'm a worse player than you because I'm a lower rank right now? Or does that just mean I have X amount of time to spend on the game, right? Yeah. Right. So, you know, should I, you know, if I don't play a lot in a month and I'm a player who, you know, I think has a fairly good amount of knowledge in the game, I could just crush everybody at the low ranks if I just stop playing for a while. And is that fair to those people? Is it fit, you know, it's because I just didn't play for 20 days, right? We're basically like, no one's really where they belong necessarily. Everyone's just where they kind of are because of how the system works and whatever extraneous circumstances have come up in their game time. So that's not really the healthiest of systems, obviously. And Yang Wu and a bunch of the devs have made the point to us that they want Legend to feel special. And I felt it. I felt that sense of accomplishment. So I agree that getting to that top should take work, should take effort, shouldn't be something that I can just glide into because I happened to win 90% of my games with some weird meta-breaking deck, and I played only 25 games, right? That doesn't make sense, obviously. But we're not talking about that. We're talking about all that stuff in between where rank 15 feels bad, you know, and it shouldn't because I just didn't play enough. Ah, I suck or whatever. Or I played a lot, but this is as high as I can get because I'm trying to play a weird fun deck. There's a lot of like weird stuff in there where those players shouldn't feel bad about themselves. And then we can still let the people who are trying to get to the very top and get those HCT points. That's very competitive and hard to do. I swear there's a system that where that works. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a combination of several systems to really make it happen. But the other thing, too, is none of this would matter to me if there was a tournament lobby and I could just play a tournament. But, you know, this is what we have now. I'm just happy we're happy as hell, all of us, to hear that they're looking at it because it hasn't been the most satisfying experience since the game has been
out. And this isn't us necessarily crapping all over it either. It's not like the system that we have now is the worst system. And when you look at it and you look at enough games, you need to look at enough data, the better player, you know, performs better, has a better win rate, gets the Legend faster, all that jazz. So the system right now is not inherently broken, but there are ways to improve it.
Mm-hmm. I just think I would like to be in a place consistently, month to month, where I feel like I am a blank Hearthstone player. I am a bronze, a silver, a gold, whatever. I am a 1 or 5 or 10, whatever they want to assign to it. But I feel like I spend a lot of time bouncing around the ladder, and it's difficult to say, unless you're a Legend player consistently month over month, it's really difficult to say, okay, I am a rank 5 player, I am a rank 10 player, because usually month to month the only difference in my rank comes straight from time. I have no idea, you know, skill wise.
You can say what the highest rank you've ever hit is, but it's always different every month.
So does that make me a rank 1 player? Yeah. I don't know. Maybe I'm a Legend player who doesn't have time. Yeah.
I'm a rank 4 player, I guess. That's what I am now. You know?
Yeah.
No, so that doesn't make sense.
Yeah. I think it would really benefit from a way to just have consistency month to month to be able to say, like, this is what my skill is in Hearthstone, as opposed to just, I am here right now, so I guess I'm that.
It's all very temporary, and none of it really defines what your actual skill level might be. Mm-hmm. And you should feel like moving up or down means like I'm getting better, or I need to work on things, or my deck isn't working, or whatever. And not, well, this is the ebb and flow of the ladder, right? Oh, yeah, well, I just went on this variance, man. I went down 3 ranks. Like you shouldn't go down so much based on some variance, and you should be like kind of understanding, you know, where you stand What, you know, am I trying to get better? Okay, let's work on that. But right now it's just like the season starts. I go, all right, here we go. Let's play some Zoo. And then,
you know, yeah, exactly.
That's just kind of where it's at. It's not really, there's no test of skill there.
Yeah, there's a sense of identity, I think, that's missing from Hearthstone's current ladder system.
That's a very good way to put it.
And Hearthstone in general, I think, has always had an identity issue because no one really says, you don't get to say, hey, what kind of player are you? You don't answer. Most people would not answer with, I'm a warlock player. Oh, I'm a priest player. No, usually it's like, well, this month I'm running mid-range hunter, tempo warrior, and Zulok, because it's what's really good right now, and I need to switch off of something when I get tilted. That's usually the proper answer from somebody playing Hearthstone right now when you ask them what kind of hero, player they are. And that's not true for everyone. There's plenty of players who play theme decks on purpose. That's the goal. That's where they find the fun in the game, and I think you are awesome. I would just like a little more incentive to play that way in Hearthstone. And the same thing goes for the ladder. I would like to talk to somebody and be like, well, what are you in Hearthstone? Oh, well, I'm a diamond Hearthstone player. And I could be like, cool, well, I'm a platinum. Sweet. And then maybe I'll take some tips from you. Let's talk about our ladder experience. But if, like you guys said,
that'd be a cool thing.
Yeah, the difference between rank 15 and rank 9 honestly isn't that much.
Yeah.
No. So. We can't, but we also can't, you know, Hearthstone is a card game, so it's different. Like, we can't force it into any box. We have to kind of let it be what it is. Yeah. You know, it's like, you're not going to be like with Melee where it's like, oh, I play Fox, you know, it's like, no, that's in Hearthstone, you know, you play multiple classes. Everyone kind of does. You got guys who are better, like you got Jab, he plays Hunter, that's his main thing, but at a tournament, he brings all the other stuff too, because you have to. But
yeah, exactly.
Like, we can't force it to be that, but at least we can like take what it is and let it breathe in a better way.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
And people are gardening right outside my window.
Oh, cool. I was about to say, it either sounds like a bat is trapped in your room or a weed whacker.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure which.
Probably sounds super weird for you guys.
Actually, no, it sounds exactly like a weed whacker. Yep, nope. Sounds like what it is. But enjoy that, listeners at home. But I think that will stop our discussion about ladder there. We'll see how the year shakes out if we get any tweaks to ladder whatsoever. I'd like to see something. I'd like to know where Team 5's head is at. You know, if they're thinking about making changes, what those changes are, I have a feeling we probably won't hear anything until they're ready to actually let us try something.
Yeah.
But anyway, before we move on to our strategy segment, where we will be talking about Yogdruid, let's thank our patrons who are supporting us over at patreon.com/TAC. That is where you can go if you like the Angry Chicken, if you like what the three of us are doing and want to support us in a monetary fashion. Head on over there and pledge however much you would like. This week, let's thank Carlin RK, Chris H, Stekib, Jefferson G, MTG Cardsmith, Drustarius Travis, Matthew A. Thank you all so much for the support. Really do appreciate it. And just keep checking out. Sorry for missing the Brawl episode on Thursday, by the way. We've been dealing with multiple family issues on the show. So that's what's been going on there. That's why we missed the episode.
And the brawl wasn't that great.
And the brawl was kind of a one and done. So
yeah.
Yeah. I got my pack and I was like, okay, cool. I got slammed the first time. I totally rolled over him the second time. All right. Random. Yeah. It's random.
So there you go. There's your brawl episode.
There's your brawl. Yep.
It's random. It's done.
Cool. Well, let's talk about Yogdruid.
Hit it very hard.
Wanna post something up? Time to pay.
So Yogdruid has been a popular talking point this week, so we're going to continue that trend by talking about it. If you're watching the video version, I have Jackie Chan's Yogdruid up, and if you're looking for Jackie Chan's version, the first A in Jackie is spelt with a number 4. You're trying to find that. But I know, Dills, you've been playing a slightly different version of this, but they're all pretty similar. And
yeah.
By pretty similar, I mean all of us heard this, went, pulled up a deck list and went, what? Wisps of the Old Gods.
Yeah, well, it's so essentially what we're looking at is token druid with Yogg as a potential comeback mechanic or finisher. So your finishers are Savage Roar and then also Yogg.
There's a lot of ways to finish in this deck, it feels like. Like, potentially, if things go well for you, you can easily find the damage.
Yeah, I think the key that we're seeing in Yogg decks in general, because recently we saw Hot Form get really high with the Yogg Tempo Mage. We've seen Yogg Hunter be a thing. Most of the decks that seem to feature Yogg aren't reliant on Yogg, because I think that's the key. You can't use Yogg as your only way to win the game because he just sometimes won't do that, you know? So what you need to use Yogg as is kind of an emergency button, like, break, you know, in case of emergency, break Yogg. You know, it's like that's kind of what his purpose is in the deck. And then your win condition is something else. And then this is like an anti-lose condition in a way, because in general, what Yogg does is clears the board, draws you some cards. That's kind of what you can expect from Yogg in most cases if you've played 10 plus spells. So this deck is mostly built around the token idea. And then a couple of people have tweaked it and done a couple different things, but I feel like the core of the deck is mostly the same in most people's versions. So the core is really the Innervate and the Wild Growth stuff for the ramping, the Mire Keeper. And then we're seeing Wisp of the Old Gods, Violet Teachers, all that kind of stuff as the way to build your giant board of tokens. And then you've got things like Savage Roar to finish. And then you've got, of course, the small amount of removal that Druid has, which is Swipe and Wrath. And now Living Roots can kind of go into that category as well, because that's can be used a couple different ways. But you're starting to see like the differences being some people are using like Cenarius as opposed to Wreckfuls using Onyxia. And Onyxia is actually kind of an interesting one. I like Onyxia a lot. Because if they've wiped your board twice, your Wisps of the Old Gods have been cleared twice. Well, do they really have another way to wipe Onyxia now too? So I thought that was kind of an interesting idea. And all of these guys have gotten really high finishes with their versions, by the way.
Chatroom is also saying that Jackie Chan recently swapped out Cenarius for Onyxia.
For Onyxia, yeah. Mm-hmm. I do think it's actually the better card of the two. Like Cenarius does have the option to buff your board. But it's tough for 9 mana to find that situation. It's much easier to do something like Wisps and then do the the Soul of the Forest on that, right? Mm-hmm. But it's really hard to have the board and then have 9 mana to buff it with Cenarius. So it's spending 9 mana should be the build your board part of that combo. But most of it is just like that core. And then we saw this version that you can find on tempostorm.com, which is very different, which is more of a ramp druid with Yogg as its kind of finisher. So there's one that's like the token version, and then there's like the ramp version, which is using Ancient of War, Druid of the Claw, and Ragnaros, and stuff like that. And only the Violet Teacher is your token building kind of win condition there. But, it's a really cool deck. I'm happy to see Token Druid be back. I think it's always been kind of a fun deck. It's one of those decks where you make these big plays and then you sit there like, oh, don't have it. Don't have it. You know, when they don't have it, it's the ultimate, like, force them to have it kind of deck, right? Mm-hmm. You don't not make the play. You do. If you have Violet Teacher, Innervate, double Power of the Wild, like, you do it. You go for it every single time. Empty your hand, and then sometimes you just win the next turn, sometimes you don't. And I think that's where the real power comes in and how to actually play the deck is it's kind of an all-in deck. It's a deck where you really make a move early on in the game and either win or don't. And I like that style a lot. I think it's really fun.
I think that's probably where I went wrong with this deck. And also I noticed the Jackie Chan version has Mulch, which was going to be like one of my questions, because I know I lost a game to a warrior. First of all, the number of whirlwind effects in warrior just makes my token sad. But I lost a game because he played Rag and I just couldn't deal with it, because there's like, you know, he's got Rag on board and then keeps, you know, dropping other big minions. And it's just like, I can't deal with everything. So I just took 3 Rag shots to the face and then like lost. So well, your game plan against one Rag, mulch, I think, is good.
Yeah, I think that's why the mulch and the single Feral Rage have both been, I think, pretty effective cards. Feral Rage actually deals with a lot of things. The 4 attack is actually a good amount. And you can usually get whatever. But when you can play it with the Fandral Staghelm and get the 4 attack and the 8 armor, it is just so damn broken. Yeah. But Mulch is, Mulch is like the only real answer that Druid has. I mean, you're not playing Recycle. You know, it's like, it's really like, I guess I have seen some people test out, one mana, make them draw 2 cards.
Naturalize.
Yes, naturalize. I have seen some people test that out because it is at its core like a tempo deck, right? I build big tempo. I don't really care if you have cards. But, you know.
Yeah, that's the thing I was going to ask you about, too, is just how do you go up against decks that just have too much power, like in terms of powerful minions? It seems a little.
Kill them with a huge board and Savage Roar. That's really. It's got some bad matchups, definitely.
Yeah, because I took this onto the ladder today, and it's new season, so I'm really low in the ranks, and I went up against Sean Player playing a deck I've never seen before. I'm not sure it's anything. I think it's just a guy screwing around. But fire guards and a bunch of fire elementals and Defender of Argus. There was just so much health with Taunt on board, I could not do anything.
Yeah. A lot of times you do end up, like, this is why I like playing the double Savage Roar version, because a lot of times I end up using a Savage Roar as essentially removal, right? So I take all my tokens and I run them into the things I wouldn't be able to deal with anyway. Yeah, and then I still have the second Savage Roar to be able to actually win. But one of the other things, too, is when these people play this stuff and you can't deal with it, that is when Yogg-Saron kind of comes into play.
Yeah, yeah. And I did not, that particular game didn't have a chance to draw Yogg, so that's very true. And also, that's not a deck I am expecting to come up against very often.
No.
But play Yogg and then he pyroblasted himself, and I was like, thanks, that could have gone to Rag, and that would have been helpful, but you're Yogg, so.
Well, there's another way. So against Rag, the other kind of option is to just go wide, right? So the Wisps of the Old Gods is great against Rag, because I've got 7-1 ones he can hit that aren't my face.
And then he Ravaging Ghouled, and I cried.
Well, okay, but see, then sometimes they just draw that way. You know what I mean? That's the name. Wisps and Power of the Wild, then they're all 2/2s. That's much better, and they can't kill him with Ravaging Ghoul. So
yeah, I definitely didn't get enough games in with this one, I will say that. But I lost every single game. I did so poorly with this deck.
Yeah.
I think it's a deck that
takes some playing, though. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be like a super easy one to figure out.
And I queued into exclusively Hunters and Warriors, which is pretty much like the worst thing to do is like fill up your board with 1/1s, because then the Hunter's like, Unleash the Hounds, and the Warrior's like, Whirlwind, and I'm like, I hate my life.
Yeah. You need to do it when you can combo it with like an Innervate and also get that Soul of the Forest out on your Wisps.
Yeah.
Because then you're just, they're going to be doing the cussing that I'm sure you were doing.
Yeah. So looking at Jackie Chan's version, I actually think that Wreckful's version is the best one that I've played with, because it's very centered around the strategy of the deck, and Jackie Chan seems to be a little spread out, so he seems to be kind of hedging bets, right? So he's got the Feral Rage, he's got the Mulch, he's got one Soul of the Forest, and one Savage Roar, and where like Wreckful was like, you know what, if I'm going to cut something, I'm going to cut Raven Idol. And he cut like Azure Drake, and he went double Wisps, double Soul of the Forest, double Savage Roar, Onyxia. He was kind of like, no, this is my strategy. This is how I win. I make a big ass board. I have like 3 cards in the deck that literally fill the board when you play them, right? You got Onyxia, you got Wisp of the Old Gods. Those all fill the board. And then because of Emperor Thorason, you can then combo them in ways that you shouldn't be able to. Mm-hmm. So you just build those boards with Soul of the Forest, and then once you draw Savage Roar, like, they can't clear it. So a lot of times, you'll notice the opponent, this happened to me tons of times, once I Soul of the Forest my board, they just went, oh, crap, okay, I guess I have to race him because I can't clear this board. And then they just start going face, and then I just laughed and double Savage Roar and won. Because, because they just realized, like, oh, I'll never get, okay, I'd rather him have a bunch of 1/1s and a bunch of 2/2s.
Yeah,
so I'll just leave them, but then I just Savage Roar and win. So I feel like, Jackie Chan's version, he got ranked 2 with, but I think that was last season. And this version that Wreckful was playing, he got legend with it in like 2 days.
He played a lot this current season, right?
Yeah, in this current season. Like, he got, there's not that many legends right now. I was watching Dog play last night, and he was playing like a ramp druid. But, all these players got there really fast. It seemed like Druid was actually popular again. But this version that Wreckful was running was just like, it was just cruising right on through the ranks. I mean, normally he plays all season. And, like, I've tuned into him late and he's still, like, ranked 5 because he's messing around. He just kind of sometimes happens upon a deck that really works. And I think his version teched out really well because it just is, like, this is the strategy. I'm sticking to it. Whereas some of the other versions I've seen are kind of like going two different directions. And I think sometimes that can really make your deck weaker in the end.
That's well put. Yeah. I'll have to try. My problem, as is frequently, I do not have a Nyxia.
I made her.
Well, I think Cenarius is fine. I just think Nyxia is slightly better.
Yeah, no,
but Cenarius is still okay.
I really like all the points you brought up for Nyxia, though. It does make a lot of sense. It's just, it's such a fallback plan. Like you said, it's like, well, you dealt with two rounds of 1/1 wisps. Can you deal with Nyxia?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's, you know, most decks might be able to get lucky and draw the Ravaging Ghouls at the right time. Yes, yeah. That does happen. Yeah. But
and I'm sure in the majority of your games, you're probably not wisping twice and Nyxia-ing. Yeah. Like the chances are relatively slim. But in those couple games where you get to that chance and you need to do that, it's very good to have.
Yeah, yeah. There's not that many games I've had that go that late. And when they do, it's kind of now is the time for the Yogg. Mm-hmm. So it's funny because you call it a Yogg deck, but most of the games I won with it, Yogg never happened. It was just a big board of dudes. I'll say this. So the interesting thing about this deck is you still kind of want to mulligan for your ramping.
That was going to be my question, is how do you mulligan? Because I think that was also one of my mistakes. Maybe not mistakes, but just I seem to never, ever draw my ramp. At most, I got like my innervates. But like I thought I forgot to put Wild Growth in my deck because I played like four games and never got it.
You're
and
clearly
then I
not
got
very
it on turn 10. I know, I'm clearly just terrible. Yeah. Then I got it on turn 10. I'm like, well, at least it's card draw and two more spells, right?
The funny thing is that Wild Growth is two spells when you cast it on turn 10. So it's two spells for your Yogg.
Yeah.
I think the key is the innervates and the Wild Growth, yes. And then you just try to like manage the board. So it depends on what you're playing against. But like, let's say if you're playing against Zoo, you keep things like Swipe. If you're playing against like Shaman, it's more important to ramp out something that can then fight back on the board, because you don't have the type of removal that's going to remove all the Shaman crap. Like you don't have something that'll ever kill a friggin' Totem Golem on turn. Like you just don't. You know. You have Wrath that does 3, and then you'll Hero Power at the next turn, taking like 7 or 6 damage or whatever, right? So that's a little bit tough of a matchup. But so I think like the ideal thing is having like Innervates, Wild Growth, and then I like to, my favorite that happens sometimes is when you do the Wild Growth into Mire Keeper, into, you know, Emperor Thorason or something like that. Those are the games you just kind of win because you just have way more mana than the other guy. So you're really kind of like looking for some specific things based on some decks, but for the most part, you're just trying to ramp. And then once you get there, you kind of try to wait until you can get that one huge turn off. So you look for the big Violet Teacher turns with Power of the Wild. Like you look for those big turns, and then that just kind of swings the board back in your favor. And then they're kind of forced to react because they realize, oh, Savage Roar might happen. So a lot of times, like if they've been the face deck, they've been the aggressive deck to that point, suddenly things switch. They start putting resources into your minions, and you can kind of turn things around from there. So it's a tricky deck because you're going to be kind of waiting, boom, big bursty turn, then kill next turn type of thing. So it takes some getting used to for sure. I wouldn't give this game like this deck five games and then say, oh, I guess this deck sucks. Like I think there's a play style with this deck that's not common among Hearthstone decks in general, and so you have to turn your brain a little bit from what you're used to doing.
Okay.
Which most decks is like drop the best minion I have on curve, right?
Right, and that's definitely
not
the case here. Yeah, I'm glad you brought up the tip of kind of play it like an all-in deck, because that's not where my brain was at. Now I'm excited to go after the show and try it out.
Yeah, force them to have it. Force them to have the perfect card that they need in that situation. Because the chances are they don't. Even though sometimes it might feel like they always do. Actually, technically, they tend not to. So, yeah.
I never assume that the deck is bad. I always just assume that I am bad.
Yeah, but see, not I am bad, but just I don't have experience with the deck.
And also sometimes
like I could take any deck and lose with it for 7-8 games, and then all of a sudden I can figure it out and then rip off a 9-1 streak, you know?
Cool.
And I think that's how, you know, you just have to play enough with a new deck.
Yeah.
You have to understand that you're going to have that moment. It's like when the first time I switched in Heroes to quit casting on Li Ming, and I was like, that's how I should be doing it. man, I couldn't do it. I was like, I suck so bad. And then after like three or four games of it, I was like, oh my God, I'm wrecking people. You know, so yeah.
It's nice. It's very nice. Well, yeah. Cool. Well, folks, get out there and try it. We've got links to all the different types of these deck lists that we just rambled off in the show notes over at namemove.tv/TAC. Look for the episode 159 post. Link to the show notes are at the bottom. Now let's take a crazy game story.
It's the whole world gone crazy.
You're in trouble now.
You got it.
You can send your crazy game stories to TACpodcast@gmail.com. Sideburns writes in and says, hey, friends, if you guys want every game to be a crazy game story, try out my wild brew I like to call Show and Tell Shaman. Now, listeners, I would like to quickly go through this deck list and point out what makes it weird, but there's a lot of things that makes it weird. A lot of things. Double Elemental Destruction, double Farsight. What else is in here? An Alarmobot, for Christ's sake. Cro-Magus, Steed's Old Shredder, Yashiraj.
Nosedormu.
Nosedormu is in here, guys. It's ridiculous. I've got a link for the show notes. Oh, Joss already posted it in there. You guys are great. There'll
I'm
be a link
it.
To it in the show notes. Anyway, so Sideburns wrote in and said, turn three, I coined out Ancestor's Call, dropping a Ysera that my priest opponent had no efficient way of killing. Ysera drew me three nightmare spells in a row before finally dying. I dirtled, which I'm not sure if I'm saying something really bad or not. I'm not sure what dirtled means. I dirtled around with hexes and totwolves until turn 8, when I dropped Alakir and cast triple nightmare on it for an 18-20 with charge and wind fury. Well played. Keep on clucking. Wow. This is a bizarre deck.
Just... It is, but I see how it works. I mean, I can definitely see that this will win because you have ways in the early game to deal with stuff. He's got the double lightning storm, the double elemental destruction, so he's able to buy a lot of time. And then he's just hoping to do some crazy shenanigans with the Alarmobot and Ancestor's Call. So I like it.
Yeah. There's a lot of shenanigans in this deck. I feel like there's a misnaming opportunity.
Yeah, he called it Show and Tell. Yeah,
this is the shenanny deck.
Shenaniman? I don't know. Shenaniman.
Ancestors call out Yashiraj. That's just gross, man.
That's pretty disgusting.
That's cheating McCheaterson.
Yeah.
No, it's not cheating because the game is allowing you to do it. That's what we call shenanigans. That is the difference.
There's a couple cards I think I might switch, though. Like, I think I might put Sogoth in this deck. I think Sogoth would just work really, really well. Just that 5/9 taunter that you can't target with anything, that people will never be able to get through it. Like, Ragnaros won't go off with Yashiraj, but will go off with Ancestor's Call, so I get that one. But, it's cool. It's a cool idea. I like it.
Sideburns, you are silly, sir. Thank you for sending this in.
I actually have a winning record with my Shaman OTK deck. The problem is that if Tempo, which is a kind of a similar thing. It's like just kill everything with Shaman cards and then wait, and then Leroy, double Rockbiter, Wind Fury, Faceless Manip, hit him for 48. But it's just that if I play against a guy who drops one taunt at the right time, it doesn't win. So it's like it's so frustrating to go, you know, play like a 20-minute game and then be like, oh, he played one taunt. I can't win. So even though that doesn't happen as often, it's like when it happens, it's soul crushing. So I decided I can't do it. Can't do it anymore.
Nice. Well, let's round the show out with some emails.
Hello.
Hello, it's me.
Hello.
Just quickly, do you get my message?
Yep.
Oh.
Hello, brother.
You can send your emails to tacpodcast@gmail.com. And our first email comes to us from Josh, who wrote in about the June season, but we wanted to have a discussion anyway because it's the start of a new season, and this is always relevant. Josh writes, Dearest TAC, I love the show and I love Hearthstone, but this June season is wearing on me. I started playing Hearthstone about a year ago and have never been serious about making deep ladder runs, but have always wanted to make it to at least rank 15. Big whoop, right? I've never had issues with reaching rank 15, but this month is proving rather difficult. It should be noted that I've only spent about $60 total on the game and to get adventures, and besides that, I quest for new packs. My main point is the majority of the opponents I've been encountering in ranks 15 to 18 have been stacked with legendaries this season. Specifically, everyone seems to have Sylvanas. This all adds up to my minimal legendary owning ass getting my ass kicked by legendaries I simply have no answers to. A couple of questions I have is, where have all the players like me with minimal legendaries gone? Does everyone play try-hard decks these days? Is Hearthstone losing the casual player to the rich who own every card? I never see ranks 15 to 18 being so loaded with golden heroes and legendary cards. Are you seeing the same? Is this good for Hearthstone? If anything, take me off the tilt. Help me, my wise counsel of TAC. You're my only hope. Okay, so there are a lot of questions here. Mm-hmm. So, first of all, I have so many questions. So, he didn't specify whether this was the beginning of the season or not.
It was the, so this email we actually got, I think, on either the 5th or 6th of June. So basically the very beginning starting the season. And we talked a whole heck of a lot about ladder earlier on. So that kind of took a little bit of the wind out of our sails for this email. But I think basically this is one of the issues we touched on before, is that it feels bad playing at these low rank. Like, if you feel like you're a level 18 player, then right now, all the legend players, all the rank 1 to 5 players, like, they're all chilling down in your ranks. So that's part of the problem, I think.
Yeah, especially at the beginning of the season. Now, on the subject of, you know, players like him who are, you know, borderline free-to-play players, if you've only spent money on adventures and nothing else, I'd put you in the free-to-play category.
Definitely.
I put you in the
almost 3 years of Hearthstone.
Yeah, exactly. But in terms of vanilla legendaries like Sylvanas, I just don't see it as unrealistic that most even players in your camp haven't gotten a hold of some of these vanilla set legendaries that everyone plays.
Yeah. At this point, Hearthstone's been out for a while. So.
Yeah.
But I think my initial reaction to this is I kind of want to dispel this notion that having legendaries makes your deck more powerful than everybody else, because I hear this a lot, and it's not technically true. You can build a deck with zero legendaries in it. Mm-hmm. It's called Zoo.
Yeah,
and
Zoo.
You can go number one rank legend with that deck.
Yeah, we talked
about
little...
You can build Aggro Shaman with zero legendaries in it, and you can go number one rank legend. You can do it. It's totally doable. These legendaries are legendary cards, not for their power level, but for their kind of what they do is weird and interesting and crazy. They're not necessarily unbalanced cards. Like Sylvanas used to be 5 mana and did the same thing and was imbalanced, right? So Sylvanas at 6 mana is not, and you can silence it, kill it. You can kill it, run 2 minions into it. There's ways to deal with it that don't mean you have to have some legendary card in response. It's not how it actually works. So I want to make sure like that is clear to everybody that like having legendary doesn't mean your deck is inherently more powerful. The cards themselves are generally balanced between, you know, this isn't Magic where everything has to be a rare, you know. Some people in chat are saying, oh, doesn't Zoo have Leeroy? Not necessarily. Some have Leeroy, but most these days are running the double Doomguard version again. So, and then even then, it's like, okay, one legendary. Okay, I guess this is an unattainable deck now. Like, I think we have to also say, like, this is a card game, and you can be a free to play player, but you're going to have to understand that it's going to take you longer to earn cards. So, you're probably going to have to play decks that have less legendaries in them. Like, I have free to play accounts, and on them, I play Face Hunter, I play Zoo, I play Shaman, because that's what works without legendaries. If I want to play Nazoth Paladin, I'm going to have some legendaries to make that work. So
right. We talked about this a little bit last week where it's it comes down to you can absolutely play this game competitively on a budget, but you are going to be restricted in what decks you can play that are actually going to work and give you a positive win rate.
Yes. Yes, exactly. And that's how it works in any card game, essentially. There's generally a cheaper option out there that can be played. Magic is kind of the exception, though. The cheaper option in Magic is to play Sealed or Draft. Like, that's your cheaper
It's to avoid the constructed option.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is exactly
so
what
at least
I do.
In Hearthstone, you do have options that aren't you know, that aren't completely going to break your bank. So, but you know, I just want to make sure that that's out front. The other thing is that, yes, you are going to see more of this now than you had in the past, because the game has just been out longer, and the free-to-play players who've been playing since the beginning have now earned a lot of these cards.
Yeah, so. And that's where my question comes in. It's like, I'm curious how often Josh plays and how much he has played in the past 3 years almost at this point that Hearthstone has been out. Because that's going to, like I said at the beginning.
Well, he did say he's been playing Hearthstone for about a year. So he hasn't been playing right since the beginning, but...
You're like on the lower end then of the players as far as what you probably earned to this point.
Yeah.
But that being said, I think, you know, take a deck that you think you can afford and concentrate on playing those decks. And, you know, I think too many people also, like, they are free to play and then they try to get every quest done on the ladder. So they're trying to, like, win with Priest on the ladder with free to play Priest, you know?
Yeah.
And man, that doesn't work very well. So I would encourage you, like with my free-to-play accounts, what I do is I play Arena with my quests. I just make sure that I can match up quests with the arenas that I play. And that ends up, like, you know, it actually double dips, because if I play Arena and actually do okay, like 5 wins or so, then the pack that I get is actually cheaper than it would have been had I bought it just for the 100 gold. But also, I got a quest done, so I ended up earning like 30 gold or 50 gold at the same time. So I got even cheaper, right? So.
Yep.
It, you know, it kind of spaces it out a little bit more. It might take a little longer, but you get a little bit more for your bang for your buck or bang for your gold or whatever. But
yeah,
and
it is a tough spot. I understand.
Brawl is actually not a bad idea either to do your quests in Brawl, because then you also get the every 3 win bonus gold.
I would argue this last Brawl is a terrible way to get
big that's asterisk.
The build your own decks where you have a little bit of control over the outcome. Definitely are the weeks where you should take advantage of Brawl. But because I know drafting an arena is really important. And if you're not an arena player and you don't really know how to build an arena deck, like me, then arena is not actually a great way to go about getting your wins, doing your quests and stuff like that, because I'm terrible. So I have success in Brawl.
You don't have to be terrible, Jocelyn. Like I don't want to get this idea out there that some people are just inherently terrible at Arena. Like, you can get good. You can get good, Jocelyn. You can get good.
I think a smart
player who understands Hearthstone. You just haven't applied yourself to Arena yet. And you're just telling yourself that I'm terrible from the get-go.
Well, it's only because there's it's a totally different play style because of the randomness of Arena. And there is that whole other skill set, which is, I would say, even another level up from deck building because of the random element. So drafting an Arena, like, that's a very specific skill. And if you don't have it, Arena can feel really bad and cause people like me to not want to play it anymore. So it does have a whole other skill set on top of actually being able to play standard competitive Hearthstone.
If I can draw a line down the middle of what Dills and Jocelyn are saying, I would say that some people just don't like Arena, and that's totally fine. And then either go to Brawls that are good for you as a free-to-play player, or just play unranked if you just absolutely have to finish that damn priest daily. Otherwise, re-roll that quest and hopefully it'll get whatever, you know, deck you're actually playing. But if what is important to you is playing on a budget and also ranking up in ranked, don't do your off-class dailies in ranked play. You will lose games. You will lose stars.
I you know, and I'm going to make a point here that some people are going to think I'm a total jerk right now, but games are hard, and it's not supposed to be like
you're not supposed to be handed
everything that you want. You're not supposed to log into a game and be like, you know what I want? I want to be legend. I don't want to pay for it. I don't want to do anything. I feel like I deserve it. No, if you want something and you want to earn it, then yes, you can have it, and that's how all games work. And everybody, I believe, if they apply themselves to it, can get there. I don't think anybody is inherently just bad at Hearthstone. I think that people need to work on the skills. Like, I'll bet you that there's a world, an alternate universe, where Firebat sucks at Hearthstone because he applied himself to welding or something. That, I believe, is true. People can do this, man. You can all out there do this. The mindset you have is, I suck. I don't have enough legendaries. That guy has all the legendaries. I'm just not good at this. Oh, my God. Like, you've talked yourself into losing, man. And just don't do that. You got to turn that off. You got to say, this is a thing. I'm going to be rewarded if I work and try. And once you do that, you will get those rewards. I guarantee it.
I've got to say, and I've noticed this a lot about myself recently, I am in a really, really bad Hearthstone mindset right now. I feel like whenever I lose, it's because I'm bad. And when I win, it's because I'm lucky. And so, like, I'm never actually giving myself credit for skill. And like, oh, yeah, I made a really good play there. That was smart. I'm always like, oh, well, I got lucky. He clearly had terrible cards. And then when I lose, I'm just like, I'm an idiot. So, like, yeah, I'm in such
you gotta,
a bad
you gotta reverse that.
Yeah, cut that out.
I'd be like, I got unlucky. That's why I lost. And then when I won, it's like, yeah, I'm supposed to
yeah,
win.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't know how to do that. But, yeah, I'm in a really bad – I understand being in a bad Hearthstone mindset. I get it.
If you have to take
that
turn
– me right now.
If you have to take turn-by-turn notes, I would do that. And I have done that to really see if – like what it is, like, well, what was my starting hand? Well, did it, like, am I playing Yogg-Druid? Did I start with both of my Wisps of the Old Gods? Okay, that's probably not a good game to, you know, really judge whether or not, you know, I'm good with this deck or not.
Yeah,
but
I think the other thing,
although
too,
if I won, then it probably
turn,
is.
Try every turn to predict what the opponent's going to play the next turn, and then, like, make the play that you think is best based on that. Mm-hmm. So, like, when I play against, once I've decided, okay, it's Warrior, okay. Tempo Warrior, I think, is what it is, right? Then once I've decided that on turn three, then I say, okay, Ravaging Ghoul, that's what's going to come out on turn three. And then on turn four, it's like, okay, he's going to play a 2/6 with Taunt. Okay, so what can I do to best set myself up to be able to get through that Taunt, that type of stuff? Oh, turn two is coming. Okay, Fiery War Axe. Like, what can I play that's going to set me up for that? And then every single turn, you're actually, like, making a play with a purpose. And you just keep doing that throughout the game. You know, what do I think the opponent's going to do next turn? And then you're kind of not thinking about how you're being unlucky or bad or whatever, and you're just kind of like focused on the task at hand one turn at a time. It's a good way to go about it. Like when I'm really when I'm really focusing, that is exactly how I'm looking at things. There's like a checklist. It's like, step one, do I have lethal? Step two, okay, what is he going to do next turn? Like then step three, how can I build my board? All that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
but it just kind of happens naturally after a while. But you gotta focus on it first.
Mm-hmm.
Get competitive, Jocelyn.
Get it. Yeah.
I know. I don't know what happened to competitive Jocelyn. Like she's in there somewhere. I know, but she's been beat down and buried.
Just smacked down a little bit. Yeah. And then, yeah. It just feels like screw it.
Yeah.
Well, we do need to move on because I know we got to get you out of here, Dills.
I'm fine for like another 10 minutes
okay,
at least.
Okay, so. All right. Well, let's go ahead and take the next email from Elizabeth Dills.
Yeah, this comes from Elizabeth. Hey, Tat Crew. So I know you all, particularly Dills, tend to advocate picking a deck and sticking with it even when you lose when trying to climb the ladder. Have I really advocated for that? Okay. But
well,
with so many fun
with
different
deck
decks floating around in Standard, I've been having fun doing a kind of King of the Hill setup. With what deck I play. Basically, each day I start off playing what I feel like. Then when I lose to a deck, if I can switch to that deck, I obviously can't do that for every deck because, oh my god, the Control Warriors play like 9 legendaries, forget that. I'm currently rotating through Dragon Warrior, Zulok, Aggro Shaman, Midrange Hunter. I'm mildly competitive in that I tend to play every day, but since I'm a full-time student, my goal each season is pretty much just to get to rank 5. I was wondering if any of you did something like this to keep ladder fun. First of all, I think what I actually advocate is have a couple decks you feel comfortable playing in two different styles that you can swap to based on what the meta is really doing. So have one aggro deck and one control deck or one mid-range deck and one combo deck and whatever. So have like two decks that don't work the same exact way so that if one's better for that current meta, you can switch. But the other thing is, if this is what you need to do to keep the ladder fun, hell yeah, man. Dude, I mean, that's what it's about. You know?
Yeah, I think this is great. I mean, we spent a good section of this show talking about what issues we think the ladder has and how they could improve it, but you can always try and improve it yourself. And so, Elizabeth, if you're digging this right now, playing your ladder King of the Hill, it's like, well, I got beat by Midrange Hunter. I'm going to play Midrange Hunter now. I dig that. I like that.
Exact thing she's talking about. I've done this on ladder where I just try to play the deck that somebody beat me with. And one time I had to make like a weird secret mage. And I was like, I have no idea what this deck is, but here's the cards he played against me. And I'll try to figure it out. And it is fun. It's super fun. But sometimes you end up tanking a little bit because you're, you know, you lose to something, and then you lose to something else because the deck you switch to is actually terrible. So now you're just like constantly losing, not because of the deck, but because, or not because of you, but because the deck you've created is actually like not that good. And so you're going to lose to whatever you play against next. So you got to be careful of that. But it is totally a fun way to play.
Yeah. I agree. I like this quite a bit, especially these three that you're, or these four that you're switching between. You actually have played quite a bit and you're good with them. I mean, why not? Whatever it is. What do you have to do to find the fun?
Octosco in the chat said, I wouldn't recommend switching styles of decks. I totally disagree. I think if you only know how to play one style of deck, you are putting yourself in a box that is really bad to be in. And I think you really need to, make sure you can play several different styles and have those different mindsets and be able to go, okay, right now the meta is definitely trying to beat aggro. So I should not be playing aggro. I should be playing control myself or mid-range or something like that. I think it's really a bad idea if you're like, okay, I'm an aggro player. Oh, okay, aggro hunter's not working. Aggro shaman. Like, people are still teching against aggro, right? So you need to be able to play a different style of deck to then, like, counter the meta. And you need to be able to play multiple different types of decks just in general if you want to be a good Hearthstone player. You need to be able, somewhat well-rounded. So try not to box yourself in.
That's sad. Joss, final email?
Sure. This one's actually a little bit more light and fun, I think. Good way to finish off the show. Justin writes in and says, hello. Maybe it's the lore nerd in me, but one thing that really bums me out about Standard is when important lore characters leave Hearthstone's primary format. Vol'jin is the biggest example. It's a bit sad that the Warchief of the Horde is painfully absent in Standard games. Next year, we'll be losing Varian, so both of the faction leaders will be MIA. I know I could go to Wild, but I'd like to play them without navigating Secret Paladins and Dr. Booms. Do you think that we might get some reprint-type cards for these characters, similar to what they did with Deathwing Dragonlord? I'd love to see something like Vol'jin Warchief or Varian Logosh. Thanks for the show.
I did not read this ahead of time, and you answered my question for me, Justin. I was like, well, they already kind of did this with Deathwing Dragonlord. So anything's possible.
I would love to see a like wolf-type version, something of Varian, like Spirit Wolf Logosh. I don't know.
That'd be super cool. No, it'd be really sweet. Because, a lot of the characters in Warcraft, unless you meet them and then they die almost immediately, have multiple versions of themselves, just, throughout history. So I'm totally down with that. And we've already had the reprint discussion multiple times at this point, so I don't really feel like going down that route. But clearly, with Deathwing Dragonlord being in the game, revisiting major players from the Warcraft universe is absolutely still on the table.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think this is the way to do it too, because when I first looked at this and I started reading it, I was like, no, we don't want to keep cards in standard. We don't want to be adding cards to the standard list that are like just forever cards. Mm-hmm. I think, and we address this at the top, what Ben Brode said,
I don't think that's what Justin necessarily is
suggesting. No, absolutely not. That's what it sounded like at first. And then I was like, oh, but yeah, like the Deathwing thing, that's perfect, because you just make a different version. It's still Vol'jin, but it's a different version of Vol'jin, does a different thing. And then it's really cool because then at some point in the future, maybe there's four different versions of Deathwing and I can go wild and make my Deathwing deck,
Yeah. Oh, that'd be so cool.
I think it's a cool idea. Yeah. I think it's fun.
So cool.
By the way, I opened Golden Illidan the other day, just in a random pack that I got off of a I think it was an arena run or something, but anyway.
Tinfoil hat, Legion promo.
Yeah, exactly. But it made me, I was like, I have to make Illidan decks now. Like, I have to. I can't not play this Golden Illidan. But it then made me realize how sad it is that Illidan sucks. So can we get the Illidan reprint that does something different that doesn't suck, please? Illidan's supposed to be a badass.
Yeah.
And Legion is happening. So, yeah. Let's fix that.
Just not hyphen suck Illidan is the title of the new Illidan card is what you're hoping for there, Dills.
It's so sad that he sucks so much, It really is.
Yeah, I'm with you. So, now bring it on. I honestly think your Deathwing deck is a really cool idea. However, I think you should be forced to play as Nozdormu first before you can put out all your other Deathwings, because clearly you are warping time.
All right.
So, thanks for your email, Justin. Thank you, everyone who wrote in. And again, send your emails to tacpodcast@gmail.com. That's going to do it for this episode. Thank you again, patrons, for supporting the show. We really can't thank you enough. It helps us in ways that you probably don't even imagine, like keeping the lights on or my internet connected to my computer. So thank you. If you dig the show, go over to patreon.com/TAC if you want to support it. You can also support us by leaving us a 5-star review on iTunes if you dig the show. Thank you to X Conway, Joe Haggernator Hagger, who said we are cluck-tasticular clucking. There's too much icular in there, I believe.
Yeah.
Still, thank you for the hard-to-pronounce headline. And J_Crow, thank you guys for your iTunes reviews. Find out more about the show on amove.tv, including show notes. You can find past episodes over there or over on youtube.com/amovetv. Thanks to our Patreon producers, Declan H., Peter Williams, and King Louie. You can get our coffee mugs and swag over at bit.ly/amovestore. Or, again, if you're going to CreateCon, or even if you're not, go pre-order your CreateCon shirts, including a new Angry Chicken shirt over at tadpool.bigcartel.com. And also make sure to do the /category/createcon to see the shirts specifically. So you can pick them up for free at the con or get them shipped right to you, guys. So go check that out. Follow the show at TAC Podcast, and we will be back next Tuesday night, crazy schedules willing, at 4 p.m. Eastern on twitch.tv/amovetv. So, Dills, where can folks find you?
Check me out on Twitter. I'm at Willie Dills, twitch.tv/WillieDillsSF, youtube.com/WillieDillsSF. But mostly I just want to give a shout out to Jury for sending me a Bootios shirt from Money in the Bank. Thanks for that, man.
Nice.
You'll find me in my Bootios shirt on my stream soon. Again, it's already happened once.
Jocelyn, how about you?
Sorry, I was totally not muted in typing. You can find me on Twitter and Twitch. I'm at Joss Plays. And you can find me right here on Amove TV every Wednesday night doing the Gamers In at 8 p.m. Eastern.
Awesome. You can find me on Twitter at Garrett Art. You can find me on Into the Nexus talking Heroes of the Storm. You can find me on The Angry Nerd talking to myself and plenty of other shows if you just go to amove.tv. All the podcasts are there. Go check it out. That's going to do it for this week's episode. Thank you for everyone for tuning in. But until next time, job's done.
Job's done.
Job's done.
Yes!